to this special presentation today. We're honored to have attorney Marian Ryan here and welcome her to the Council on Aging to share her expertise in the opioid epidemic and to give our senior citizens tips on how to secure and manage your prescription medication. I'd like to also thank our honored guests for attending, Representative Kenneth Gordon, he'll be here. And thank you to Bedford TV for taping today so that folks at home who maybe couldn't make it today can watch this later from their home. We'll also be hearing from Chief Bongiorno, but let me hand it over to Representative Gordon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Allison, and thank you, everybody, for coming out to attend. It's really my pleasure and my honor to be joining with DA Ryan, Marian Ryan, today. And I'm so impressed with the initiative that you've taken, that she's taken to bring these issues that are important to our seniors here. And she's gone from town to town talking about not only the opioid issue, but also the crank calls that you've received, that have gone to a session that she's done about that. And if these issues are something that you have questions about today or after today, you know, don't be afraid to call the district attorney's office, call my office, and you know, these are things that there is help out there. This issue of opioid abuse is important, and the reason is that there's a misperception out there about when people read about overdoses, they read about abuses of this type of a drug, they think of this drug as kind of a street drug. What's happened is that there's a lack of information, which the DA can provide today. There's a lack of information given to people when they take these types of pain medications away from a hospital, a treatment center. We need to get that, we need to fill that gap, and that's what this today, I think, will be about, and it's a great resource. And again, as always, you know that I come here every month. It's usually the second Monday of every month, but there's always a sign out there for when I'm here. Please come. We're usually here in the Flint Room at 1 o'clock, so please check it out. I'm always available on my website, which is easy, repkengordon.org, or Allison can find me if you want to come see me. Okay, so I'm going to turn it over to Chief Bongiorno. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are you doing? So let's see. Update. Are we rolling? Two sick. The boys are sick, pneumonia, and double ear infection. So as you can imagine, challenging times over in the Bongiorno household. But with that said, we're just so fortunate to have leaders in this community like Rep. Gordon and District Attorney Ryan. They have been so supportive of police and public safety. One of the things about opioids that's a misnomer is that Bedford is not affected. Well, I can tell you that Bedford is directly affected. We've had deaths, we've had overdose deaths, and it's the leadership from District Attorney Ryan in her office that is setting the tone for 54 cities and towns across the Commonwealth. So I think the important take back today is that Bedford is not immune to this epidemic. And as you listen to the district attorney, it truly is an epidemic. As I was thinking of something to say about the district attorney, many thoughts came to mind. Three L's: leadership, listener, and liaison came to mind. Her leadership to lead 54 police chiefs who are all type A's is a challenge in and of itself. And you should see the district attorney at our meetings, how she controls the room full of chiefs. It's quite fascinating. As a listener, she listens to the needs of the community, she listens to the needs of the police chief, and she's always accessible. Quick story, when we were dealing with our issue here in Bedford with the anti-Semitism, there were times that the district attorney and I would exchange texts and voicemails and emails late at night. One night it was about 2:30, and the district attorney and I were exchanging texts, and my wife rolled over and said, "Is that the district? Are you bothering the district attorney again?" So that's the type of leadership, and that's the type of listener she is. And as far as the liaison, her office has been so supportive of our community here in Bedford. If there's something we need, whether it's on the opioid issue, whether it's on something, one of her other many tasks that she fights for, she's always ready, and ready, willing, and able to serve. So I'm proud to call Marian a friend. And a leader. And without further ado, are you going, District Attorney Ryan? Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you all for being here. And you know, today's a great example of what we sometimes take for granted, particularly here in Middlesex, because we're so fortunate to have it. And that is, you know, nothing, fortunately, nothing bad has happened. And yet you have here myself, the chief, the representative, Gordon is here, all for the purpose of making sure that something doesn't happen. And we forget about that. You know, it's easy to sort of criticize government and criticize public officials and what are they doing for us. And this is a perfect example of that. This is folks making time, taking time out of their schedule to be here just to prevent something happening. And it also goes to illustrate what I'm going to talk about in a little bit, which is when one of these issues arises or when you have a concern, call the police. They don't mind you calling them. If you're wrong about something, they're fine with that. That's what they're there for. Call the State House, speak to Representative Gordon or someone in his office. Talk about what you're worried about because we want to prevent that. I have 54 cities and towns, as the chief said. I prosecute about 40,000 cases a year. Most of that, we open the door in the morning and things just come through the door. The best part of my job is being able to prevent that, to cause something not to happen. And that's what we're really looking to do with this presentation today. And I think when you leave, and I'm very grateful to Allison for having us and for getting you together to hear about this, you'll certainly have information that will be different at the holiday table, I guarantee you, and gives you a different sense of this problem. Because the chief is right. People read this in the paper. They hear about someone passing away from an addiction, and they think it's someone they don't know. They think it's not the kids who grew up here or played sports here or the people in your neighborhood. But if you picked up the Boston Globe yesterday morning, you saw on the front page the story of that woman who's raising her young grandchildren, who looks like everybody we know and who said very honestly in that story at 62 or 63, whatever she was, this is not an age when I expected to be raising babies. And yet here she is. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about how common all of that is. But I want to talk first about just what this epidemic has meant in terms of the resources that are being put to it. And what's confusing in many respects for me about this is I've been a prosecutor for over 30 years. I remember other incidents like this that were public health, public safety issues. And I'll give you two easy examples, which I'm sure everybody in this room remembers as well. The first is driving under the influence. We all remember when this time of year, the holiday season, was riddled with the stories of one big fatal car crash after another. We all remember when graduation prom season used to be marked by all of these incidents. And when I started in the DA's office in 1979, across Massachusetts, we had about 3,000 people a year who lost their life in those kind of crashes. 3,000 people. And finally, and it was mostly a grassroots effort, folks like Mothers Against Drunk Driving, who said, this is ridiculous. We are losing so many people. And there was really a sea change in how people thought about things. All of a sudden, it wasn't okay just to go out and to drive drunk anymore. It wasn't okay to go to a party and hope you made your way home. And we started things like designated driving. The courts got much tougher in the prosecution of OUI offenses. And keeping in mind, as is true with all of this, one person losing their life is too many. But last year, the death toll from OUI crashes in Massachusetts stood at about 251. That's a 90% decline. And that's just a change in people's attitudes, a sense that it's going to cost you a lot of money, it's embarrassing, you might go to jail, all of those things. And the other one is smoking. When I started in the DA's office, we shared offices, and they were about this big. And I shared my office with a person who smoked more than any human being I've ever seen. There was a cigarette in the ashtray, a cigarette in her hand, and another cigarette being lit up just to be ready. And there was smoke everywhere. And when you walked through the courthouse, the most prominent feature in the Cambridge courthouse was we had marble ashtrays that were about 3 feet high, and they were everywhere. It was like Disney World, you know, with trash cans. They were about every 5 feet. And the whole building had this haze of smoke in it. You remember you went to Dunkin' Donuts or you went someplace in the morning and there'd just be a wave of smoke.
And the same thing, people kind of said, this isn't safe, we need to stop doing this. No one right now would sit in their office and blow smoke across their desk at the person they work with. No one goes out to a restaurant, sits down, and when they get to coffee, lights up a couple of cigarettes. We just don't do that anymore. And that's really what is going to have to happen with this epidemic. Because right now, in terms of the money and the time, and the chief certainly knows this, I probably spend at least 60% of my week, every week, on opioid-related issues. We are spending massive amounts of money on this issue, and yet the numbers are going in the wrong direction. And to give you just a little sense of what it means in terms of resources, I have 20 state troopers who are assigned to my office, and they investigate any unattended death. So whenever someone dies who's not in a hospital or not in hospice care or some setting like that, we go out to investigate that. In the last 5 years, we have investigated 716 fatal overdoses. So that means on 716 occasions, my troopers have been dispatched to go out with the local police departments to investigate an overdose. So that's 716 times they can't be doing anything else. And that requires probably on average about 3 or 4 hours by the time they go out. We take people's cell phones. We try to find out who else might have bought what they're using. We have to connect with their family. There's a lot to be done. So that's one piece. The second piece where the resources are being stretched is in hospitals. In the last 5 years, we've had a 201% increase in the number of people going to our emergency rooms for an opioid-related issue. And no hospital has gotten a 201% increase in their budget. So on top of everything they're dealing with in an emergency room, we've now got this massive number of people who are coming in. Either they may have been Narcan'd by a first responder given the opiate reversal drug, they may have been brought in by a family member or from some other facility, but they have to be cared for as well. And I know 201%, you kind of don't know what that number means, but in Massachusetts, it's 60,000 people, which is exactly the take at Gillette Stadium. So if you filled every seat at Gillette Stadium, that's 60,000 people. So we've just taken that whole group and just sent them out to the hospitals and said, here you go. And a piece that people don't think about that in my office we've been spending a lot of time on, we have 8 birthing hospitals across Middlesex County. And they vary greatly in size and the number of births. But every one of those hospitals is on average delivering 1 substance exposed newborn a month. So there's at least 1 baby who is being born that they've been exposed to opiates during the pregnancy. At least 1 a month. And to give you a sense of, never mind the suffering of those children as they detox over the first 16 to 21 days of their life. But the normal birth of a child, when the mother goes in, delivers the baby, spends 2 nights in the hospital, everything goes well, it costs a little over $4,000 for that whole event. The obstetrician and the anesthesiologist, whatever you need, about $4,000. These children that are born substance exposed, from the moment of birth until they're released from the hospital, usually about 3 weeks later, the cost ranges between $63,000 and $95,000. So, and every month, each of my 8 hospitals is delivering at least 1, some many more than 1. And that is not looking at the health needs of those children going forward, the educational needs they may have when they're ready to go to school. So that is an enormous drain on treasure. And we're at a pace now where, as you can see, as the governor's been making budget cuts and other things and has even had to cut some of the spending on opioids, it's really not sustainable. So we have to really be in the prevention business, because trying to fight this from the back end and just putting massive sums of money on it is not going to work. And we still have to pave the roads and build the schools and build the senior centers and do all of that. So that's the other piece of it. So today, we're going to talk a little bit about how this has become a priority for us and what you can do both to protect yourself, to detect some of the issues that may be out there, and most importantly, how to make sure your medicine is not falling into this whole cycle that people are feeding off of. But I want to start by giving you a little sense of the scope of the problem. That's a map, if you're not familiar with it, it's in your packet as well, of Middlesex County. And every mark that you see on there represents a fatal overdose that has occurred since 2012. In 2012 was when I first noticed that we had a number go up. And at that point, that year, the number was 65. As of right now, today, I'm at 243. So you can see in 4 years what that number has looked like. And in addition to the 54 cities and towns with just about 1.7 million people, a population that's greater than 11 states in the country, we also have, and I'll talk in a little bit why this is so significant, we have 26 colleges and universities across that county. So talk about people who are experimenting, people who have access to lots of going home, lots of other people. We've got that whole influx of college kids that come here all the time. And Bedford, as the chief said, is not immune to this. To date in Bedford, we've had 3 confirmed opioid-related deaths. And there's some others that what happens is sometimes the police arrive and they see what appears to be opiates right there. They may even see a needle in somebody's arm. They may see something. So it's clear what's happened. Sometimes it certainly appears that that's what's happened, and then we're waiting for the toxicology result. If you look at this graph, graph, there we go, okay. So this tells you just the year. The red number is the number of deaths. So we're at 241. We had 2 over this weekend, so we're actually at 243. That number in green is what we've already confirmed from the lab as being opioid related. And our experience is that 90%, 90 to 92% are opioid related. So whatever we haven't heard back from, the vast majority of them are going to come back as being opioid related. So I'm going to give you a little bit of the history of how this all happens. This is the poppy flower, which is the source of all this misery. One of the most beautiful flowers in the world, grown almost exclusively in Mexico and Afghanistan. It is grown now really for the production of drugs. We'd like to think people are putting them in their garden, but in Afghanistan and Mexico, there are fields and fields and fields, and it's just really for the product. And what happens is you see that bulb, the kind of bulb piece of the plant. If you were to cut that open, you would get that white, sappy, sticky substance that we all know is kind of inside a plant. And that substance contains 3 chemicals. And those 3 chemicals, a couple of which you've heard of, those 3 chemicals are morphine, right? High level of pain relief. Morphine is the drug against which all pain relievers are measured. In the medical world, you take a pain reliever and you measure it. If morphine is 100% of pain relief, it's 50% as strong as morphine, 25%. It's just the gauge. To give you a sense, some of the things that we're seeing on the street now are 50 to 100 times stronger than morphine. So morphine has always been the highest. Some of the things that are out there, things like the carfentanil, all of those things that people are starting to introduce here, that's why we're having so many people die. All right, the heroin is bad enough by itself, but now you've got all kinds of other things out there. Codeine, the cough suppressant, that everybody's familiar with. And then thebaine, which is what we're going to be most interested in. It's thebaine that's used to make heroin. So those 3 things in combination come from that plant. Now keep in mind what I said about fields of plants growing, because it will kind of explain when we talk a little bit about the synthetic opioids. Because you've got to have fields to grow these poppy plants and get this liquid from inside the plants. So what has happened is there's been the development of opioids. And when I first started hearing that, I thought people were saying opiates wrong. So opiates are the 3 things that come from that plant: morphine, codeine, and thebaine. Opioids, which actually means opioid-like, there are 2 different kinds. One is the semi-synthetic, so you take some of that thebaine and you mix it with other chemicals. Right? Many people in this room probably have some semi-synthetic opioids at home. If you've gotten a prescription for things like oxycodone, OxyContin, Percocet, if you've ever been on any of those, if you had a knee or a hip replaced, you probably got some of those for painkillers. Vicodin, all of those are semi-synthetic opioids, as is heroin. Okay, they're all the same family. You start with thebaine and you just change the ingredients that you add to it. Then there are completely synthetic opioids. So you don't need the fields now. All right. The most popular, unfortunately, right now is fentanyl. All right. I can make fentanyl in my basement because I don't need a field to grow flowers. So it is entirely man-made. The other, in fentanyl, is also used very often as a long-term painkiller. If you have extensive surgery, particularly back surgery, where you might have opened up a lot of your back, you've got a lot of area that's going to be in pain, you're often given fentanyl as a painkiller. It typically comes in a patch. So you put the patch on, it's time released. Right? The other synthetic that people know well is methadone. Right? Methadone is one way of treating people who are on heroin, is to give them methadone to allow them to wean off the substance. When people talk about treatment, there is a distinction between treatment which uses drugs, because make no mistake, methadone is a drug as well. It does work very well for some people. It allows them to function normally, to have a job, to do all of those things. A downside of it is you usually have to get it every day. So they're having to go to a methadone clinic and get their methadone. And you can either be weaned down off the heroin you've been using, or there are people who are on methadone for years and years and years. All right? It is different than some of the other treatment, which does not include the use of opioids. So those are the ones that we're most often dealing with. How do we get to this problem? And this is a pretty good graph of how this happened. You probably have heard a lot of talk about the drug companies and how complicit many people feel they've been in the development of these drugs and the fact that they're so addictive. When these drugs were developed, there was no confusion about the fact that they were incredibly addictive. The issue was they were developed, and this is all about the late 1980s, early 1990s. They were developed to control end-stage cancer pain. And if you think about what was going on at the same time, that was around the time that people started to believe, rightfully, that many people who have cancer, who are at the end stages, would prefer to be at home. That was the real introduction of hospice care and managed home care for people. So you want to be able to bring a family member who's in end stage cancer home. It's not a very attractive option if they are unfortunately screaming in pain 24 hours a day. These drugs were able to manage that horrific pain. So they made it possible for people to come home. Lots of prescriptions for oxycodone, whatever it was. Pain was managed. Quality of life was reasonable. People could pass away at home. All right, so that's all happening like about 1988 through the early 90s. And that's all great. It's all good. All right. And everybody knows, no one is the least bit confused that people are going to become very addicted. But frankly, they aren't going to survive that long, so the addiction isn't going to be an issue, right? At the same time, there's the sense that there are some folks that have usually cancer, but some other kind of illnesses where pain is great. They are going to live a fairly long time, but addiction, pain, the balance is they are good candidates for those drugs. So they're being given those drugs, and there clearly are people who are in such pain from whatever it may be that they need that strength of painkiller. You have to be conscious about the addiction. They have to be treated very carefully. Okay, so good uses over here. There then became the development that if the pain relief was so good, it would also be very good for a short-term acute incident. So they started using many of these drugs, for instance, in a cesarean section, right? So for instance, a woman goes into the hospital, she has a cesarean, she's in the hospital a couple of days, she's had major abdominal surgery, right? Lots of pain, really needs to be resting for several weeks, but has to come home, get up, and take care of the baby, right? Virtually every obstetrician in the United States now, when you have a cesarean, prescribes an opiate because it is what allows you to come home essentially having had big surgery after 48 or 72 hours and be able to get up, walk around, and take care of your baby. Now, to give you a sense, we'll talk about this a little bit, most obstetricians prescribe for that woman essentially 75 milligrams of the opiate for the entire time they're going to need it. And usually, most obstetricians will tell you that by the time the mother comes back for her 10-day checkup, she's fine. she's okay to be without that level of pain medication. She can take Tylenol, she can do whatever. So she's ingested from birth to that checkup approximately 75 milligrams. Right? And doctors are surprised if anybody needs more. In fact, they then become concerned. Is there an infection? Is there something else we need to be looking at? We have people now who are using in the several hundred milligrams per day. So that's the strength and the difference in what they're using. So it began being used for cesareans. It's also used in emergency rooms for, you know, you're on a ladder today putting up the holiday decorations, you fall off, break your arm. They have to wait before they're going to set it. They're going to give you some opioid painkiller to get you through some period of time. Right? Something happens on Friday night, you can't see your primary care doctor till Monday, they'll give you an opioid prescription. All good, it works well, you feel much better once you take it. The problem is that the physical addiction level for opioids is 6 days. So after 6 days of taking opioids, you can develop a physical addiction, right? Not everybody's gonna develop it. Nobody knows really who's gonna develop it. That's one of the issues behind our prevention and aiming particularly at kids. Because some people take them, and we all know people like this who say, I don't like how they make me feel, they don't work well with my stomach, I feel very foggy, I can't wait to get off them, all right? The person sitting next to you maybe takes them and thinks, this is the best thing ever, all right? And they're going down that path. And nobody knows who's gonna be that person. I mean, there are some things like a genetic predisposition and things like that that make you concerned, but we don't know. Everybody knows families where there are people deep in addiction and people who are high functioning who never touch anything. So there's no real clue of that. So you've got what they were designed for, you've got what they became used for, the acute care. And really what has gotten us in trouble is this piece in the middle, where now everybody gets an opioid prescription for everything. I'll give you an example. I have a daughter in college, and last holiday break, she and a bunch of her friends were all getting their wisdom teeth out over the holiday break, because they'd have time to recover, obviously. To a person, those kids were given opioid painkillers. Right? Sort of a mix, Percocets, oxycodones.
I was going to say, when I had wisdom teeth problem, and back that time, three or more teeth, and it was covered in the hospital.
Yep.
Not now. But I was working, and what was it, codeine. I was given something with codeine.
Yep. See, in another part of that plan.
I felt like I was flying around work, but it was only, you know, to tie me over till I had the surgery.
See, and here's the difference. If you think about it, right, you have a tooth out. Except, all right, so the first day you're probably pretty good because you're all Novocained up. The second day you're probably going to be in a substantial amount of pain. By the third day, unless you've developed an abscess or something's going wrong, you should be on the upswing. You're starting to get better. So, but when you give kids a 10-day supply, that's a lot of drugs, right? And the other piece of this, which is really a societal piece, is we're all very busy. Nobody really has time to be sick. Everybody judges, in some respects, how well they were treated by their doctor, the hospital, by how quickly they were able to get back to their regular life. Doctor, I got to get back to work. I need to be able to drive. I need to go back to school. And the problem is that opioids fix that. Opioids make you able to do many of those things. So that's that quote from the Commissioner of Public Health, who talks about people who come in who say, you know, my child has strep throat, they have whatever. We're a busy family and we can't take a week to stay home. I need them to have enough of whatever to get them back to school, me back to work, everybody doing what they need to do. And that's part of the problem. You know, doctors have become more willing to write the scripts for these things. People are more willing to take them. And people are not always great advocates for themselves in terms of, what am I taking? Is there an alternative? And there's not a lot of discussion. You know, I'll give you an example. My husband had some surgery a couple of months ago at a Boston hospital. Everything was great, great doctors, great hospital, everything was fine. He was in the hospital for a couple of days afterwards, during which time he was on Tylenol with codeine. So that's, he was managing his pain fine. So now we're 48 hours out, he's coming home, the nurse hands me a stack of prescriptions to get filled. And when I get to the CVS, you know, some of them are pretty harmless. There's salve to put on the scabs and do all that kind of thing. But there's a prescription for 90 oxys. Now, he hasn't had any oxys at all. All right? And we've had no discussion about, is there a problem with him? Is there a problem about anybody in our house? You know, we have two adolescent kids. No discussion about that. And that's another piece of it, because nobody's having those conversations. And then people are getting those drugs, not necessarily fully understanding how addictive they are.
So they're not asking for them. They're being given.
Right, right. And you're being told, as everybody knows, if you're in the hospital or whatever, the doctors are saying, stay ahead of your pain, all right? Because they got that little smiley face, and they want you up at like a 7 or an 8. They don't want you slipping down to a 3 or a 4. So they want you to be taking enough to be doing that. So that's part of the issue, is just how much we're using them. And how much, you know, everybody wants to get back. How many people do you know have a surgery? The first thing they want to know is, when can I drive again? When can I be out walking around? And I need to have enough pain medication to do that. And a piece of this is this prescription. So you look at back at 1991, in the United States, 76 million prescriptions were being written for opiates across the country. In 2013, which is when this graph ends, although I can assure you it continues to go up, we were at 207 million. All right? People didn't get a lot sicker. All right, people are just using them more. That's part of the issue, is that, and that's that much more prescription that's out there. So, okay, prescriptions, you can think about, yeah, maybe it's not a great idea to do that, but how am I getting from a prescription to a heroin habit? It's all money, right? It's like the movie, show me the money. Because when you become addicted, you have sort of a time-worn path. When defendants come in and they start to tell their story of addiction, I could write the story. Most people first get introduced through a pill that they somehow either have legally gotten for themselves, or they're helping themselves to somebody else's medicine cabinet. So assume they're my prescription. I take my prescription for the 10 days or whatever I have. This is great. This is the best thing ever. I really need these. I physically now need these pills. I go back to my doctor. Maybe I can get my doctor to write me another 10 days. If I'm really lucky, maybe he'll write me 2 more 10-day prescriptions. All right, so now I've got, I'm 30 days out. And I mentioned the college piece before, and that's been a particular problem for us, because it is not unusual for us to respond to an overdose in a college setting where a college kid has 200 or 300 opiates in their room. So the question is, how are they getting them? All right, so think about it. I'm a college athlete. I get injured. I've gone to the infirmary, or I've gone to the local hospital. I've got my 90, maybe twice I've gotten 90. Now I go home on Friday afternoon to Long Island, and I go see my primary care, my pediatrician, somebody else. I get another script. All right, all of a sudden, I've got double what I had before. So that's a real concern for us. We've got a lot of kids who are not from here. So even if we were using the physician's management program, the doctor here can't see what the doctor in Long Island is doing. Now, as of about 6 weeks ago, 8 weeks ago now, I guess, there is an agreement between 44 states in the United States. For instance, New Hampshire is not one of those. I have lots of kids who come and go from New Hampshire. New Hampshire is not part of that national agreement, so we can't see what they're taking. But that's one. All right, so now I go back and forth to my doctor. I manage to get myself 30 days worth. Now I really need them, right? I can try for a while lifting them from somebody else. I can try trading with other people to get them. Some very creative things. For instance, one of the initiatives we've developed is talking to real estate brokers, because on Sunday afternoon they go out to an open house and they tour the bathroom. And maybe in the bathroom there's either some leftover medication or there's some medication out on the counter that I take. I don't take the whole bottle, I take 3 or 4. All right, if I take 3 or 4 from 4 open houses, I've got another week's worth maybe. All right, so I can string that along for a little bit. The problem is the pills are expensive. A 50 milligram pill, which is what you see here on the left, of opioids, whatever, of some variation, is worth about $50 on the street right now. It's about $1 a milligram. Unless you're extraordinarily wealthy, you're not going to be able to keep that up for very long. And remember, what I told you, we've got people with hundreds of milligrams a week or a day they need. And your addiction continues to increase. That's one of the problems with opiates. What satisfies you today is not going to satisfy you next Monday or Tuesday. You're going to need more. So not many people can manage to legally be paying for that, buying those. Now, one of the things in an unusual consumer twist, heroin, when I started in the DA's office, sold on the street, that bag of heroin would have cost you about $60 or $65. It now costs you between $3 and $5. So take your pick, $50 for the pill, $5 for the bag of heroin. Right? One of the crimes that you probably have seen if you read the local paper, because every nice suburban neighborhood has been hit with it, right? You put your car in the driveway, we don't lock the car doors, and then you read that people have gone up and down the street and they take the change out of the cup holder or wherever you keep the change. All right. So my husband was completely puzzled when he started reading this in the local paper, saying, well, they're only getting $3 or $4 out of every car. But coincidentally, that's the price of a bag of heroin. Right? So I work my way down your street and hit 10 cars, I'm buying 10 bags of heroin probably, because I probably am getting $3 or $4 in quarters and nickels out of everybody's car. So that's the path that people take, and pretty quickly down that road. So you can see how somebody who's got a habit that's $300 or $400 is pretty quickly getting the heroin. First they're snorting it, and then within a very short period of time, they're shooting it because they can get a quicker high. And then even the heroin's not enough, so they're looking to buy heroin that's cut with other things. As I say when I talk to the kids in school, you know, there are no FDA regulations about how they mix the stuff in the basement and what they put in there. So people, you know, if I'm a heroin dealer, I buy a brick of heroin for X number of dollars, the more I can make it bigger, the more I can make when I put it in those little bags. So I'm not going to be terribly picky about what I'm mixing it with. You know, some of the more benign things are baby powder or baking soda or something that I'm doubling the size I have. Now remember, people's need is increasing as their addiction gets greater. I'm the dealer. I want to be customer friendly. I will do better if I keep selling stronger and stronger. So I'm going to mix things in that are going to give people a better shot. That's why fentanyl is so popular. Fentanyl makes the heroin that much more potent. One of the things that's particularly dangerous about fentanyl is, and this is an example probably everybody's seen, you know, if you are making something, you're making a cake or a pie or some kind of mix, pancakes, whatever it is, you have the dry ingredients and you have some wet ingredients and you mix those up. And whether you mix them by hand or you use a mixer to do that, you blend it all, right? And the bulk of it is going to be pretty well mixed. But it's almost impossible when you tip that over to dump it out, not to get those clumps that didn't quite get mixed. You got clumps on the bottom of the bowl, clumps on the side of the bowl. One of the properties of fentanyl that helps to make it so dangerous is that fentanyl clumps. So if I have a bowl of heroin and I throw the fentanyl in it, now I'm stirring it through, it doesn't spread evenly through the fentanyl. So that is why, you might remember a couple of weekends ago, there were the four young women who were using down on the South Coast, New Bedford, I think it was, four young women using together, two are dead, two overdose but survive. Because what happens is, even if we're buying from the same dealer, I got my bag of fentanyl, you got your bag of fentanyl, maybe yours is really well mixed, yours has got some of those lumps in it. Okay, those lumps are pure fentanyl. Remember what I told you about stronger than morphine. So now, even somebody who's an experienced user, who knows that they've been able to use one bag, two bags, whatever, they're not accounting for the fact that they've got this shot of fentanyl in it. That's why they call it a hot load. So now I use that fentanyl, and what's going straight to my heart is that pure fentanyl, not just the heroin. So you can have people all using from the same batch, some die, some don't. And the chief certainly knows this, the unfortunate reality often is when that happens, as soon as the people who survived regain consciousness, what they want to know is where they can get some of that stronger stuff. So, you know, we often are in the situation where they're still trying to grab back from the people who didn't survive because they know how much more potent that is. Their need has increased so much. They're looking to have that be more potent. Now, some of the health effects of this, obviously people know the physical dependence, The tolerance, as I said, your tolerance grows exponentially. What worked last week is not going to be working next week, so you're going to need to keep getting more. The actual disorder itself, is the substance abuse disorder, is when it affects your ability to conduct your life, whether it's to go to school, go to work, raise your kids. That's when you're suffering from substance abuse disorder, when drugs have essentially taken over your life. We see it often on those college campuses. It is interfering with people's ability to raise their children. To give you some extent, some idea, right now today in Massachusetts, we have 34,000 kids who are being raised by their grandparents. I used to think that that was probably because we had lots of people who'd gotten sick or had accidents or whatever. Today, 80% of those kids, or 30,000 of those kids, are in that position because of an opioid-related tragedy. Either their parents have died of an overdose, or they've become unable to parent. So I was last week up in Lowell at a statewide grandparents' commission, a room probably twice the size of this room, literally standing room only, packed with people from across the state. Raising their grandchildren. And that ranges from, you know, the 79-year-old who just picked up their substance-exposed new grandson, and it is like having a colicky baby on speed, all right? Just the wailing and the withdrawal of those drugs, and now you're 79 years old, or you're 82 and you're raising a 3-year-old, or you're 75 and you've got a sulky 12-year-old. So you've got all of that going on, all right? You might have moved into a downsized situation. Now you're trying to figure out what to do with those kids. Most people's retirement plans don't include the expenses of a child or a teenager. So you've got that piece. You know, so as one woman said at this meeting a couple of weeks ago, Social Security doesn't really cover daycare and sports fees at the school. So, and there's no pot of money to help people with that, really. You know, that pool is very small. And then you've got also kids who we've developed in our office Project Care, which is to help with a mental health response to kids who see their parents overdose. So you've got kids who are not only in a situation which would be difficult anyway, being raised by their grandparents, but they're also kids who have had a long road to getting to this point. Have often seen overdoses, you know, because usually the fatal overdose is not the first. So, you know, you said there was a story just yesterday, I guess, some kids who parents were dealing with their own substance issues, dropped their kids off at school on Friday. What was it, 17 below zero or something with the wind chill? The schools were canceled, dropped their kids off at school anyway. And so now we had a group of little kids outside in the schoolyard, not responding to phone calls to come back, had gone off in search of whatever. Were really fortunately saved by some public works official who happened to go through the school parking lot and saw the kids out there, improperly dressed, first of all, and then standing out there in the weather. So that's the piece that people aren't thinking about in terms of who are the victims in all of this situation. Now, some of the things that you see, and you know, we all think that we don't know anybody who has these issues. The reality is probably everybody in this room knows somebody, whether you know it or not, that they have a disorder, suffers from this. But some of the things that go missing, among the missing, and you think first, obviously, of the cash in your credit cards. I spent 20 years before I became the DA being the chief of our elder and disabled unit. So any crime that happened with a person over the age of 60 would come across my desk. Enormous numbers of cases where the credit cards were being run up either by adult children or grandchildren. So maybe you gave them the credit card because it was winter, you didn't want to drive, you had something going on, they were going to go to the grocery store and get something for you. And they did, and they came back, and they gave you the credit card back. But they also took the number off and the little security code off the back. And they're using that to buy things. Very often they're buying things, particularly online, because think about it, if you buy online, you don't have to show anybody your credit card, you just give them those numbers. You get things, and then you're returning them and using the cash to buy drugs. Some of the things that people don't think about as much, the most interesting being the left, the top left there, the teaspoons. Virtually, you go to a Learn to Cope meeting with families that have folks in addiction. Virtually, the first thing that everybody will say, they will talk about the fact that at some point they noticed their teaspoons were disappearing. So you realize you have a few less teaspoons, you know, you think they're going in the dishwasher. And then I was in a meeting one day where a mother was explaining that she thought the kids were taking bowls of ice cream into the family room. And that the reason the spoons, she thought the reason the spoons that were there were bent was because the kids were digging into the hard ice cream and the spoon was bending. Well, of course, it's being used to heat and use heroin. So that's something people don't put together. Another piece is hard candy. For some reason, the use of opioids makes people just constantly need to have something in their mouth. So, you know, you have grandchildren over, they might take two or three of those little hard candies, the red and white peppermints or something that are out. When you're finding hundreds of those wrappers, probably something going on there. Aluminum foil disappearing because it's often used to package drugs up to keep them dry. So we often find drugs in little cubes of aluminum foil. So somebody will report, you know, I just bought a roll of Reynolds Wrap. It's gone. Where is it gone? It's gone to something else. And then finally, the disappearing of the drugs. And as well, what is not up there is very often people are clever enough when they have an addiction and they need money to be taking things you aren't going to miss for a while. So we will often find out, for instance, that, you know, grandpa's lawnmower is missing during the winter. He's taken the lawnmower off and sold the lawnmower because you're not looking for it. Gets to be April and all of a sudden the lawnmower is gone. Vice versa with the snowblower. The snowblower disappears as soon as the last snow is gone because he knows he's got 4 or 5 months before you're going to look for that snowblower. And in the meantime, it's gone. Right? So, you know, things, anything that's in the house, I mean, probably one of the saddest I always think is I have literally had hundreds of cases with people's wedding rings, engagement rings, gone. Just disappears out of the house. Or the good jewelry that you don't wear very often. It's now your granddaughter's wedding or something. You go to take out the good pearl earrings or something. They're gone. And they've been sold somewhere. And we're not terribly successful at getting those back. The substance abuse disorder, which is the actual name for all of this, has both the physical, emotional, and social aspects of that. And then the question is, how does that really affect you? How does that as a senior affect you? It's a couple of ways. The first is those thefts that I talked about, whether it's your property or it's your drugs. One of the things that I've been really stressing with people is when you get a prescription, you need to, first of all, be sure you know what the prescription looks like. So if it's something that you're regularly taking and you know what it is, if it isn't, if a doctor gives you a prescription for something you haven't been taking before, you need to ask the doctor or the nurse practitioner to open the PDR, the physician desk reference. They all have one, and it has a picture of what you're supposed to get. So you need to know that you're taking what you're supposed to be taking, right? And the second piece is that when you get a prescription, so you get a prescription for 75 pills. You go to CVS or Walgreens or someplace, you bring them home. You need to count those pills. Because if you have a substance issue, where would you go work? Someplace where they have drugs, right? Drug stores are a convenient place for that. So I was talking about this one day and a woman raised her hand and she said that she had just in the last few days picked up some prescriptions. She and her husband had some medical things going on. And they were supposed to be 90, and one was like 88, and one was 87 or something. And she was annoyed because she thought either she or the insurance company paid for 90, and they didn't get them. But that's something you need to be reporting to the pharmacy, because maybe they all fell on the floor, or maybe you got somebody who's grabbing one or two out of every prescription they fill. At the end of the day, they got a nice bottle of pills. And the reality is, you know, you're missing two pills, you're probably not getting dressed, driving back down to the pharmacy to complain about your two pills, but you do need to be reporting that. And the other piece is, so you bring home your prescription, you know you have 90 pills. Keep track of those prescriptions. Because what typically happens is people, even if they count them, they think, okay, I got 90. It comes to be 86 days from now, and you realize you don't have any more. Well, when you call the police department or you call my office, in 86 days, you might have had 15 people in the house. So we don't know who could have touched those. So you need to be checking your pills every week or every 10 days. You know, if you've taken 10, you should now have 80. You shouldn't have 77. We had 4 cases come in the week before last, all the same. All cleaning people had been in the house. When people recounted their prescriptions, they were down. And again, they're not taking the whole bottle. So you're down maybe by 5 from where you should be. But think about it, if I clean a house and I'm picking up 5 or 10 at every house I go to, that's a lot of medication that I'm taking. So you need to be thinking about that piece. The other piece that is difficult is the manipulation and the coercion. So very often we are finding people being manipulated either to give up their medication or to give up the money. We had a case in Cambridge about a year ago. A young man was pressuring his uncle to give him money for his habit. And the uncle lived on a very fixed income. He couldn't give him very much. He'd give him $30 or $40. And, you know, what's concerning is most people, regardless of how limited your income might be, if you are a senior citizen in Massachusetts, you probably have some kind of monthly income, whatever it is. So security, pension, whatever. So what that means is, if I'm your niece and I come and pressure you for $30 or $40, and that gets you very close, giving me that much money, I go off. And maybe I know you don't have any more to give me. But come January 2nd or 3rd, you got a new check. So I'm coming right back to get more. And what happened in this instance, he'd been pressuring the uncle for a long time. The uncle was living very close on his own money, but he'd give him a little bit of money. And he showed up one day in December last year, and the uncle said, I just don't have it. There's been some heating expenses, whatever. You know, I just don't have even a little bit extra. They got into an argument. He ended up throwing his uncle against the bathroom wall so forcefully that it brought down the tile on the bathroom wall. The uncle didn't survive that throw. So we've got lots of situations where people are getting pushed down flights of stairs, things are happening because they're being pressured to give up money or drugs. So if that's just a way that we want people to be sure that they know what's going on, if you feel like that, and people are embarrassed, it's people you love, it's, you want to think it's something else, they're trying to get themselves together, they're going to repay me, they're not going to repay you, and they're not really getting themselves together if they're continually coming back. The other piece is your pets. This is kind of gives you an idea of the level of addiction and is another way that people are getting pressured. We had a call a few months ago now from a woman who had a dog, a small dog, devoted to the dog, took meticulous care of the dog. Something had happened to the dog, dog went to the vet, dog had some kind of surgery, and she was very carefully taking care of this dog. And the dog wasn't improving the way he or she should have been. She had the dog back and forth to the vet. They couldn't figure out what was going on with the dog because she was doing everything that she was supposed to do. Well, eventually she went back with the medication and they're having a conversation and they discover that the medication that's in the dog's bottle is Tic Tacs. Because a very frequent pain reliever for dogs is fentanyl. Dogs and cats is fentanyl. So she had a granddaughter with a substance disorder who was coming over, taking the fentanyl out of the dog's bottle, putting Tic Tacs in. All right. You know, funny in the sense that it speaks to the level of addiction. I mean, you're taking the dog's medicine, but also gives you kind of a window to how driven people are. And since then, we have done a partnership with some veterinarians because they continue to see it now. People, either somebody in the family has got a problem, they're taking the dog's medicine, or people have pets of their own that they are injuring, purposely injuring, so that they can get the scripts that would be written for the dog. So vets are starting to see, you know, in the way that people would have reported abuse of children, the same dog keeps coming in with ripped paws, broken legs, whatever it is, because there's somebody in the house that's got a script going. So we've been working with the veterinarians to be sure they're asking those questions. You know, it's certainly not impossible that the senior who's bringing the pet in has an issue, but who else are they living with? Who else is coming in and out of the house? And then I mentioned a little bit just the impact on the family, the raising these kids. The other thing is what we're often seeing is, you know, people who've worked hard their whole lives, who set aside money or made a plan for their own retirement, their own care, whatever, who are going through that money to help with somebody who's in a substance issue. We got a call just the other day from a woman who previously worked in our office who has a daughter who had a great job, well-educated, everything was fine, had, in the typical path, had some kind of surgery, developed an addiction to opioids. The family has now essentially gone through every penny they have, putting her in and out of one program after another. Most of these programs aren't covered by insurance, so they've, you know, and literally it's $20,000 here and $25,000 there. And they are now in the situation where she's not really going to be taking good care of them unless things change dramatically. And they've spent through what they spent. You know, it takes, you can spend, as we all know, you can spend $40,000 or $50,000 a lot faster than you can save it. So they've gone through pretty much everything they had trying to do that. So how can you protect yourself? A couple of ways. We first of all have given you in your packets that file of life. Many of you are familiar with those. You fill them out with your information. You put one on the refrigerator so that if an ambulance or somebody has to come, they package you and they grab that off and take it with them. It has all your good information. Two things that we hope you will do from that. One is you fill out the medication piece in pencil. We want you to be thinking when a doctor takes you off a medication, have you finished that medication? And what are you doing with what you have if you haven't finished it? So you've been taking something, you've got 8 or 10 left. Doctor says you don't have to take that anymore. What are you doing about that? Or doctor puts you on a new medication. Do you really know what that looks like? You know, will you know if somebody's been messing around with your bottle of pills? Because you got to know what it, they all kind of look alike. So especially if you take sort of a host of medications. The other good piece is just you'll see in there, the file of life is great in terms of your family contact and things. If something happens in your house, one of the things I think is particularly sad is somebody goes out for a walk or something, they take nothing with them. Something happens, and we have a very difficult time figuring out who they are and who we should be calling. So you'll see there's a small one in there. You can just fill that out with all the same information. You know, if you go out for a walk, stick it in your pocket, whatever. If something happens, people will be able to get in touch with whoever you want them to do that. I talked a little bit about the monitoring the medication and most particularly thinking about where you're going to store them. I mentioned the open houses. You know, think of your medication as that dollar, that $50 bill I showed you. Be sure you're not leaving it around. You know, the holidays are coming. You're probably going to have people in and out of your house. Even if they're picking you up or dropping you off, they use the bathroom. Think about where your medications are. Lots of people put them in places where they won't forget to take them. So they've got them lined up by the coffee pot. They've got them lined up in the bathroom windowsill. It's a real temptation, either for somebody who's experimenting, you know, kids start experimenting by grabbing pills out of the bottle, or somebody who's got an issue who, you know, I'm picking you up, Nana, and I'm just going to run in and use the bathroom. And 3 or 5 pills later, they're out there. And the next piece is just the disposal. We have used a lot of our drug take-back forfeiture money to buy the take-back boxes. They're around town. You know, you can take your pills down there, no questions asked, 24/7, just drop them in. And when that box fills up, we get the police department safely gets rid of them. That is an enormous resource. We take literally hundreds of pounds of drugs off the street every month. And that's things that people are not finding to use or to get out there and sell. And the other piece is, you know, and this is a hard piece to think about is we are often seeing now people who are on very fixed incomes, who have lots of prescriptions, doing damage to themselves by not taking all their prescriptions because they're selling them. So, you know, we have lots of people in, you know, senior housing or something, especially this time of year, there's heat costs, you want to be able to give people gifts, you want to do whatever. It won't be so bad if I don't take my medication 2 days of the week and I pick up $100 by selling them. So that is something just, you know, the people you know to just kind of be aware of. It's become a real issue for us in some places, particularly some retirement communities. We've got a lot of unsavory people hanging around because they're buying. So, you know, people don't want to think about that, but it's a temptation because you've got a lot of medication. They're $50 a piece. It's only a couple. I can easily get rid of a few. Maybe I'll go to the doctor a little bit early. I'll get some more back. Won't bother my heart if I skip ones. And the other piece of it is, not only is it putting your own health at risk by not taking the medication, but it also makes you more likely to fall. It makes you more likely to have so many more other life-altering consequences. So that's really the message. We want people to know what they're taking, be checking what you're being given to take, keeping track of what you have, where it is, and what you, you know, if you're traveling, think about how you're packing up your medication. You go to stay at a relative's house, where's the medication going? You should be thinking about all of that. Think about that bottle as being full of $50 bills. You wouldn't be leaving that around. Don't leave your medication in the car. Lots of times people are traveling, they leave their medication in the car. And then when you're done with a medication, and I'm sure, I won't ask you to raise your hand, but I'm sure many people have those bottles in the back of their medicine cabinet with the ring of dust on the top, all right? Yeah, because you're saving that up in case something happens. Just get rid of those. So I'm happy to take some questions. I'm sure the chief will as well. Yeah.
I am sending for my bill. I want to send in my prescription because if they send it automatically, I'm getting stockpiled. And I've called them and I've told them don't send them automatically. I don't want it like that. I'm getting stockpiled on this medication. None of them are opioids. They're just blood pressure and that type of thing. But and there's only two. But still, they want to. I don't know whether it's less money or what, rather than mail them. But maybe this is what's happening.
So part of the legislation that the governor signed a couple of months ago, that new opioid legislation, one of the things it has in there is a partial fill provision, which says that if you have a script for something that's like, you know, 150 of something, you can ask to have it broken up. You know, I only want to get 30 or 45 at a time, whatever that is. You can definitely do that with the pharmacies. The piece that has not been ironed out is, for instance, if you're ordering them by mail. Because they, if you can get them to do it, and a lot of the places won't do it, they are probably going to charge you more money. On the theory, obviously, that they now have to ship two packages or three packages. Yeah. If they're sending more. And, you know, the other piece is, I know we all say that's blood pressure medication or whatever. We have lots of kids who end up in the hospital. You probably heard about and think they don't really happen, but they do. The pill parties, where the admission to the party is having a handful of pills. So people grab pills out of the cabinet. So we have lots of kids who end up in hospitals because they've been taking Nana's blood pressure medication. All right, so it isn't just that they don't know what they're looking for, so they pull out a bottle that says, you know, whatever, hydro, whatever it is, and they think, okay, that's good, and they take their handful of pills, and off they go, and somebody's now ingesting those. So that's a new health risk for kids. We have lots of kids and young people who the doctors are now saying to us, you know, they're 30 or 25, and they've got the body of a 70-year-old. Because, you know, that stuff is great if you have that condition to keep you alive. You shouldn't be just popping them. But people are. You really have to be keeping track of it, the medication. And that is an effort we're going to have to address again, is trying to get people to mail fewer of them. You know, and it's the push and pull of, you know, then people will wait too long and then they'll be complaining they didn't get their pills or whatever. But you're right. Lots of people have a month's supply sitting around the house, and we don't want that.
How are you addressing the problem with the medical profession as far as giving all of this medication and, you know, that people haven't requested, but they're just pushing it on?
So we have partnered with BU Medical School. We've put together a program called Scope of Pain, which trains anybody who has a DEA number who can write a prescription. So doctors, nurse practitioners, anybody who can write them. Probably not surprising, the two biggest offenders in terms of writing the number of opioid scripts are orthopedists and dentists. They are the people who write the most. Because if you think about it, right, they're probably the people who see the least of people in addiction. And the other part of it is, that's pain that's very hard to measure. If you have a tooth removed or something, and you go in, oh, my jaw is killing me. You can't really quantify that. Like, I can't do a CAT scan and say, well, gee, you don't seem to be having pain. And then, obviously, the soft tissue orthopedic stuff, you know, my back is killing me, my knee joint is still really sore. So we have been educating them. As you've probably seen, you know, up until this year, it was possible to graduate from medical school without ever taking a course that taught you about addiction or how to prescribe. It's interesting, when I do the scope of pain trainings, we've done them three times. They will only do 100 script writers at a time because of the way the exercises work. So we've done 300 people now. And the teachers are great. But you can see as they teach, they don't make people raise their hand, but they will go through saying, now, if you were going to, you know, here's patient, they'll give you a little example, and here's patient A, and patient A is asking for this script. You should ask these questions. You can very clearly see on the faces of lots of those people, ooh, I didn't know that. You know, they'll say the gold standard is at that point you would say, is this an issue? And it's pretty clear people are not asking those questions. So, I mean, it is a two-pronged piece. It's people not necessarily understanding the implication of it. And think about it. I mean, probably until very recently, the odds that I, especially like in a suburban community, I as a doctor was writing for an addict were probably pretty small. So I could probably pretty confidently think the people who told me they had pain and they needed pain medication, they really did. I mean, that has kind of been turned on its head. And the other piece of it is there's the demand, you know, people saying, you know, I need this to do whatever. And from the doctor's perspective, there is that self-interest piece of, I don't want you calling me Sunday night, telling me you need another script. I'd rather give you more on Thursday because it's a long weekend and I don't want you calling Sunday saying I'm in a lot of pain. So there's sort of a lot of competing interests here. And it's really a question of getting people educated that are writing the scripts, getting patients more educated about the idea that, you know, there is a certain amount of pain associated with some things. We can't necessarily medicate that away, and then striking that balance. Yeah.
Not all medications, though, are addictive.
Right.
And you have to differentiate what you're suggesting so that, for example, Nan talked about mail order. I'm a diabetic.
Yep.
And I welcome the fact that they keep track of me so that I don't run out of insulin.
You're right. Yeah.
And so I think there are different answers for the same problem. It's not different problems with the same answer.
You're absolutely right. Because as I said to her, you know, the problem is then you don't want somebody saying, well, I'm going to control it and I'm going to wait till Thursday to order my medication, and now we have a snowstorm, you're a diabetic and you don't get your insulin. So yeah, there is, and you know, there's no question, as habit forming and addictive as these medications are, there are people who are able to live their life because they have access to these painkillers. I mean, it's a trade-off, but it requires monitoring. It requires your doctor really knowing it. You know, one of the things that we filed a bill last year that was subsumed into the governor's bill was one of the biggest sources of these medications is things like emergency rooms and the pop-up clinics. Because you go to your primary care doctor, you've been going to him for 15, 18 years, right? He knows your story. He probably knows your family, he knows what's up, and he's gonna know something in writing scripts for you. You go to the emergency room, they just met you 20 minutes ago. They're not taking a whole lot of information. You go to these pop-up, the bone and joint places, all of that. Those people, they just don't have time to get to know you. So those are, you know, when they talk about sort of the pill mill kind of things, those are the places where it's very easy to get scripts. You know, the concern is not when you're going to the same person you've been seeing for 30 years and they know your story, they know you're a brittle diabetic or you're not a brittle diabetic and you need whatever, and it's all being monitored. It's usually associated with some catastrophic kind of episode or injury. You're now treated by somebody who doesn't know you, and then we're kind of off to the races in what's happening.
In today's medical arrangements, the long-term person who may know you, your primary care physician, has retired.
Yeah.
And in the new world of medication, the primary care physician barely knows you because you get 20 minutes at the most. And the last time I saw my primary care physician was a year ago. I have a new time coming up, and that's concerning me in terms of the medical profession and the conditions that your insurance company puts you under.
I'll give you a perfect example of that. I mentioned the babies that are being born substance exposed. So obviously there are the people who, you know, somebody is pregnant and we know they have a substance issue. So you anticipate that that baby is going to be born substance exposed. We have increasingly, just in the last 6 months or so, been having babies born where the OBGYN delivers the baby, baby's fine, everything's good, and 12 hours later that baby is in withdrawal. And no one had any idea, no idea that the mother was using substances. And one of the primary reasons that's been happening is we are finding, for instance, women who have particularly mental health issues, long-term mental health issues, that have been well controlled with medication. They've been taking this medication since college. It's completely prescribed. It's worked for them. It allows them to have a normal life. Everything is great. Well, one of the things they've discovered, and it goes to your point, you know, when you go to the doctor and they give you that little slip and it says, you know, fill out what your prior medical history is. Did you ever have a heart attack? Did you ever take this medication? Whatever. Well, a number of these women did not answer when it says, do you regularly take any drugs or whatever it says? Because they don't even think that's, as one woman said to the OBGYN, it's like brushing my teeth. I've been taking that medication for 15 years. It's medication. It's prescribed by my psychiatrist. I'm not even thinking to report that. All right. I find that kind of astounding that you don't think about that. But what a national survey has shown is that in any of those questions, when you only give the patient the clipboard, all right, and that's not accounting for language issues. It's not accounting for I don't hear so well. It's not accounting for I don't read so well, whatever it is, that 80% of the time people misreport information. Okay, so nobody intending to deceive, but they either don't understand the question, they forget things, whatever it is, they are not accurately reporting information on that form. Now the doctor's off and running with the information on that form. So what they have found is if you could have a person, a live person, like a nurse practitioner or whatever, so assume you can't have the doctor, have that conversation so that when you say, you know, have you ever had a seizure? Well, I don't know. I had seizures as a child. Does that matter? Well, when you have a form, that conversation is not taking place. But when you do, the increase in accurate information is exponential. Yeah.
One thing that's we're beginning now is the advent of telemedicine, which is with something like a social security number, you know, there's a lot of information about our financial history, other types of history. Well, our medical history is important.
Right.
And you mentioned the college athlete who gets a prescription and goes home and that doctor yep. knows nothing about it. But that person's medical history is what it is in both of these instances. So to the extent that we're beginning to have some sort of an opportunity where one doctor will just call it up and they know, oh, you were just prescribed this last
right.
week, and they could address some of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's everything. It's like for that purpose of knowing that you have the drugs, but even to be able to somehow get an accurate read of information. You know, you may have seen the story, the series in the Globe a few weeks ago about the mistakes that happen in medical settings. Incredible mistakes, very often triggered by people just not having filled something out right, people reading it wrong, not accurately confirming with the person, are you the person who has this problem? I mean, there's a lot that we could be doing better, but it requires money and it requires people. I mean, that's the reality. It requires somebody being able to sit with someone and say, okay, we're filling out this form now. You know, have you had these conditions? Have you had this problem? And that need is balanced by, as I mentioned at the beginning, the enormous amount of time and treasure we are spending on this epidemic. I don't see us having a lot of increase in people who can talk through the form with you at the rate we're having fatal overdoses. So that's the challenge for us. Yeah.
This may be a 10-minute answer, but recreational marijuana, is that irrelevant to this, to the opiate problem?
I think that what, you know, and the voters have spoken about that, and we are now doing our best to enforce that. But one of the issues is probably the most common drug user right now is the polysubstance user. So it's somebody, you know, people very rarely have nothing else going on in their life, and then they're using heroin. And it's kind of a lifestyle. I mean, what we typically hear from people, for instance, who end up in the drug court, you know, they started drinking at 12. At 14, they were drinking and smoking marijuana. Then they were doing this and they were doing that. Does everybody who smokes marijuana go on to heroin? Of course they don't. But is that a setting where very often the next thing after we've been smoking marijuana is we're having those pill parties, we're going on to other things? So I doubt it's going to make it better. I think it's a question of how it's going to be managed.
I think that's a great question. when I was doing drug work, you just, you know, I think the district attorney hit it very articulately that, you know, if you smoke marijuana, does that mean you're going to shoot heroin? Probably not, right? Maybe not. Mm-hmm. But look at the risky behavior. I just don't think you decide one day. It's very rare, other than someone that's been overprescribed, but it's very rare that you have someone that just decides to shoot a heroin. So there's that pattern of risky behavior that's developed and followed. So is it a gateway? I'm not a doctor. I'm just a little cop. But I would say yes. And you know, I really believe that if you in all instances, I don't think by experimenting with marijuana will lead to heroin. But I certainly think there is a history and a gateway leading up to that risky addictive behavior.
I think the other piece, which is, and the chief knows this as well, is, you know, I think a lot of people found reassurance in voting for the legalization of marijuana on the theory that I went to college in the 60s, I smoked marijuana, it was okay. The marijuana now is not the marijuana of years ago. There are 100 different types. It's got all kinds of chemicals sprayed on it. You virtually, you know, I've been prosecuting cases for 30 years. I remember what marijuana used to look like 30 years ago. It virtually doesn't even look the same. It's infused with so much other stuff. So that's another issue. Yeah, because of all this stuff that's sprayed on it, mixed with it and everything. So we will see.
Mm-hmm. It isn't long term, and that you know, if you run out or something, they're going to send you back to your doctor. So, in some way, that has helped make a check on what the doctors are doing.
You're right, and it's very rare now, for instance, to have a handwritten prescription for most opioids. Now, most pharmacies require that you have an electronic prescription, so it's not as simple as, you know, I grab some pads off the doctor's desk and I'm scribbling my name on the bottom. So that is, you know, it's all in an effort to make that harder.
Prescriptions they won't allow a refill if it's not new.
Right.
Because, you know, if you can run that through, everybody's got a printer at home today. You can run that through a printer.
Right.
But they have something about it that will detect it. I don't know what it is, I've never had it done. But I'm glad that they've stopped that.
Yeah. Yeah, everybody's trying to make a dent in this. Well, thank you. Thank you all for, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Another question. I'm thinking about, once identified, what kinds of treatments are available to help the addicted person or the families who are coping with it, and they see up there help is available.
Right.
And it lists under treatments 1, 2, 3 programs that seem to be available. And so I think in reverse, the Alcoholics Anonymous program, where there are programs in all communities, and maybe 2 or 3 with different names. You go as an anonymous person. What works for the anonymous alcoholic is when one alcoholic talks to another alcoholic. And I'm wondering if that kind of program would be a goal for someone in your position.
It's a goal because the life coach, you're right, the life coaches, as they call them, the person who's been through this, are helpful to people. We have, for instance, a program with Jewish Children and Families, which is a mentoring mother. So women who have young children who have beaten addiction themselves help the mothers of substance exposed newborns. You know, I've done it, you can do it, help you that. I think the problem is you really need 3 kinds of treatment. You need detox, first of all, so get it out of your system. We are fortunate in Massachusetts. We have a substantial number of detox beds. Where we have the bottleneck is, if you were using today and you needed a detox bed, you could probably get a detox bed. So you do your 7 to 10 days, now your system is clean. What you need to do is then go to the treatment program. And this number here, which is the substance abuse hotline, that is supposed to help anybody identify what beds are available right now, because that's a very risky time. We have a lot of people die of an overdose because they finish detox, there is no treatment bed, they go home for a couple of days until there's going to be a treatment bed. Now their system's cleaned of the drugs, they use, and they die. The number of beds that we have the fewest of are those actual treatment beds, because those beds really cost money. That's where you've got to do the actual work, the psychoeducational work. You know, it's not just now you got the drugs out of your system. Now, what is it that was causing you to use them in the first place? How are you going to repair those relationships? What are you going to do going forward? And then you need the follow-up care, which is even people who go to a program, detox, do a treatment program, do well. If they move back home, the odds of them doing well are very low. I mean, you really, because you tend to just, it's part of, as the chief said, it's part of your social scene. If you move back home and every Friday night, everybody you know went out and drank and used heroin, well, it's going to get pretty lonely after a few Friday nights. So the best programs are aftercare programs in a place where you're not with your old buddies, because you probably were using with people that you knew. Or in some cases, even your own family members. So those are the beds that are costly, because that's where you have the life coaches in the treatment and the aftercare, you know, that's a costly program to run. You have to house them. People don't necessarily want them in their neighborhood, so you have to find a place to put them. And you want people, as they begin to recover, to be able to resume life skills, to be able to start looking for a job, to start maybe re-seeing their children. And having a setting where all that can happen is expensive. So that is the shortage. And that is where people really bottleneck. So, you know, when you're actively using, it's easy to get you someplace. It's then what are we going to do once you've done that? And then the places that are listed over here on the side, a lot of the programs will not talk to anybody except the patient. So these are some resources for people who have folks in their family. And actually, Wicked Sober, we put that up there because that is one program. We've done a lot of work with that program, and they will talk to people who call about a family member. Because the majority of programs, you call and you say, my son is using, and they say, well, your son has to call us. And they're not going to help you. Wicked Sober will help you to give you some intervention strategies in terms of how do you get the person to be willing to go. And that's the other thing. When you've got somebody who's willing to go, you can't say, come back in 3 weeks. You've got to have a program for them to go to. Well, thank you all. Have a wonderful holiday. Thank you. And thank you to Allison for having us, and the chief, and to Representative Gordon.